For just a moment, we're going to jump ahead now, a year or two, just to tell you what ended up happening. Everyone thought we'd become a state in 1911, but we didn't. The delegates to the Constitutional Convention included a provision allowing the citizens to recall, meaning to fire, elected public officials. Now, President Taft didn't entirely object to that, except for the fact that it included the recall of judges. When Arizona sent the proposed Constitution to Washington, the president vetoed it. So it came back to Phoenix, where the people removed that provision and sent it back to Taft, who then signed it, and Arizona became a state. And of course, our first governor was George W.P. Hunt of Globe, who had been the president of the Constitutional Convention. A huge man, shaved head, walrus mustache. He was elected to 7 two-year terms, but not consecutively. But back to the issue of recalling judges. Of course, in the very first election after statehood, the voters put the objectionable provisions right back into the Constitution. What's fun is this footnote. In the 100 years that followed, there has only been one case of a judge actually being recalled under that provision. According to Arizona historian Marshall Trimble, it was in Pinal County in 1923. The voters recalled a fellow who later was legally judged to be mentally incompetent. But back to the story. In mid-1910, attention was really focused on the politics of the election of delegates to the Constitutional Convention. The politics had to do with Democrats and Republicans, of course, but more so with the labor movement, Mormons, women's suffragettes, and prohibitionists.
There was a long history of political activity by women in Arizona. To begin with, it began as early as in the 1880s, 1870s. And I think, from my perspective, a lot of it stems from the liquor business. In 1877 or so, Phoenix had 500 people, 250 Mexicans, 250 or so Anglos, and 16 saloons, 4 dance halls, and multiple gambling houses. So that was one saloon for about every 10 or so people. And that was not unusual. Phoenix was a farming town. Compared to a mining town or someplace like Prescott, much more. So in this era, alcohol and gambling played a big role. I think that as women came to live in the state, they were the recipients of the downside of that. There was abuse, there was, the paychecks were all being spent on things other than things they needed domestically. So women became active in an effort to control alcohol. And Josephine Brawley Hughes, in Tucson, started that movement in the state, and as almost immediately they found out it was a political problem, and that they would need to be able to vote if they were ever going to change it. So the focus changed from prohibition, though it was important, to suffrage. And as early as 1881, a Mormon legislator named Murat Masterson, I think, introduced suffrage bills for women in the territorial legislature. They were never passed. Finally, every session, a bill was introduced, and eventually there was a bill passed that in the late 90s that allowed women to vote in school elections if they were property owners or had children in the school. Full suffrage passed both houses of the legislature in 1903, but it was vetoed by the governor. It was an accident. There was always a gentleman's agreement that one house would vote for it and the other house would not, but they slipped up that time, and the governor had to rescue them. So as time went by, Francis Munns, Pauline O'Neill really became politically skilled. This was a long-term battle for them, and they became close allies with the Mormons, who were also opposed to alcohol. And because of that connection, that was one of the reasons that the suffrage bills failed, was because the governor that vetoed the bill in 1903, off the record, said it was because it would have given Mormons control of the legislature, doubled or tripled their vote. So it was a period of time where their support with the Mormons was helpful to them, but it also was detrimental to them. What really came to help them was when they allied themselves with labor. During this period, labor was on the ascendancy. Labor needed as much support as possible to confront the business owners, and they formed an alliance with women, and in exchange agreed to support suffrage. And as things moved closer and closer to a constitution, that combination of the labor movement, the women's movement, and to a degree some other religious movements, the Mormons and others, created a really strong political force. And when the National Progressive Party adopted a platform plank supporting women's movement, supporting women's suffrage, the Arizona party adopted that platform as a whole, and so the women and labor were able to say to the Democrats and Republicans, if you don't adopt a similar provision, all of our support, and there was plenty of male support as well as female support, will go to the progressives. And in order to avoid that, both the Republicans and the Democrats adopted a platform supporting it. They controlled all the newspapers. There was no opposition. And so when eventually the issue came before the voters in 1912, after the first election after statehood, initiative petition drive, it passed 2-1.